90-ish percent chance it's a Mobileye camera that's in the vehicle. They kind of dominate that market, at least right now. Obviously, Tesla got away from Mobileye after their crash in Florida, but still, most of the OEMs use Mobileye for their ADAS features. So the camera is a 1-megapixel camera, 52-degree field of view. It's by far the most common camera in vehicles today. So that's primarily the camera we use, although we did work with some other tier one suppliers to test their systems as well. So I'll just share with you some of the key findings. If you're familiar with pavement markings at all, you'll see some of these may be surprising. But under nighttime conditions, which is generally what the FHWA worries about when it comes to pavement markings, we found that for these systems to be reliable, you really only need about 50 millicandelas of retroreflectivity, which is, if you're not familiar with that, that's a very low amount of retro. Primarily because the cameras are looking so close in front of the vehicle, there's so much headlamp illumination out there, it really doesn't allow opportunity for retro to do its job because there's so much diffusion illumination on the pavement. So generally, this is pretty surprising to most DOTs when we talk about, hey, you only need 50 for this technology to work, whereas most DOTs are trying to provide somewhere like 150 to 200 for the human vision system. So this isn't really a big deal for DOTs. They see 50, right, Rick? 50, no big deal, right? You can do that any day of the week, right?
Our maintenance contracts, I think they have to go out and rescribe it about 150.
Yeah, so you're already at 150 as an in-service performance level, and you only need 50 for these systems to work. So the nighttime wasn't a big deal, and that's primarily what we focus on in the United States when we look at this particular asset. How well does it work at night? But what we found was during the daytime, we need to start doing a better job of maintaining our markings so that they provide better visibility during the day, particularly for machine vision systems. We generally don't need that as we drive. We don't need a really good delineation system on the road during the day because we've got so many other cues around us about which way the road's going. We can generally drive without markings during the day effectively, and we've done it in many instances. Where lane markings are worn in a two-lane road, it's only marked as a one-lane road, but we drive it as a two-lane road just fine. But when it comes to a machine vision system, it needs to know, if that's relying on an edge line or a lane line, it needs to have that information. And it needs to have it in a way that's reliable. And so what we learned was, and what we're learning is, we need to rethink, or we need to, I guess, put a little bit more focus on to how do we maintain our markings for daytime appearance so that these systems that are in the vehicle that provide these safety features can reliably detect them. And so there is a way to do that. We just don't do it very well in the U.S. Actually, nobody does it in the U.S. But if you go to Europe, it's a common practice in Europe. So it's not like we had to reinvent the wheel. We're just bringing a measurement system that's already in place in a different part of the world here and recommending it to the U.S. with some specific thresholds. And it basically measures the daytime diffuse luminance of a road marking. It's called Q-sub-D. ASTM already has a test method and a specification for it. Again, it's just that it's not been a focus of the infrastructure agencies in the United States. And that's primarily because when we look at crashes, lane departure warm, or lane departure is a big piece. Roadway departure is a big piece of our crashes in the United States, over 50% of our fatalities. And we think about what ways can I infrastructure my way out of it. But this being a new way to get out of that dilemma, we need to rethink and be sort of creative about, okay, well, how do I maximize the efficiency and effectiveness of this technology? So daytime is going to have to be something that we focus more on as DOTs go out and maintain and design pavement markings. The other thing that we also looked at was what is the benefit of going from what is nominally, and we generally have a minimum width of 4 inches on our road markings to a wider marking. We've already demonstrated through various research that for human vision, this would be a, this is a good thing to do for safety. But what about machine vision? Well, again, because these systems are only looking out 30 to 50 feet in front of the vehicle, we didn't see a benefit to a wider marking in terms of reliability and consistent high-level detection rates. Because it's the systems that we tested weren't looking out to a point where pixel density became a critical issue. If you get to looking at some of the systems that are in the Tesla, where now they have 3 cameras in the windshield and one is specifically designed for far detection, if you were to just take that camera isolation alone, wide markings becomes a little bit more important. But with the systems that are currently available on most cars today, this isn't necessarily helping the machine vision perspective, although, like I said, we've shown how it helps safety from a human vision perspective through several research efforts in the past. So one of the things that I've got a chance to do over the last 24 months is talk to auto industry quite a bit about what is it that we could be doing from an infrastructure perspective that would, if they had a chance to just dream about, what are the things that they'd like to see on the highway? And I listed some of the things that are the most common things I hear related to road markings anyway. And so I just thought I'd share this with you as you think about what else could we be doing from a infrastructure perspective, because I think it kind of gives us a chance to think about some innovation that we haven't really had an opportunity to introduce into our thinking for a long time. But I started off the talk by, talking about how auto industry says, yeah, you just need to maintain your markings to a higher standard, but they don't really know what that means. So we're trying to define that. But in addition to that, are folks familiar with a bot dot? Okay, so if you're on the West Coast, you know what bot dots are. This is one of those regional things in our world that you don't necessarily get exposed to a whole lot, but bot dots are the ceramic buttons out in California that are used for lane lines. They provide a little bit of a rumble, but they don't use paint or tape in California very much. They just use these little 4-inch ceramic buttons, and that's what marks the roadway. So you may have a picture of what those are in your mind. The auto industry and machine vision systems generally hate those things because they're very hard to reliably detect. Why? Because they like to do edge boundaries and look for edge boundaries, right, in their machine vision systems. And to do that, you need nice, crisp edges. And box dots don't provide that. And so that's one of the main things that they talk about a lot is let's get rid of the box dots. Let's maintain your markings to a higher standard. Maintain crisp edges along your markings. The other thing they talk about are the lane lines, or what we generally call skip lines. Those are 10 feet white lines with 30 feet gaps. So if you're on the interstate system, those skip lines that you see are 10 feet long with 30 feet gaps. So the auto industry and those working on machine vision technology would like us to do something other than a 10-30. They'd like us to do the 20-20 maybe. And we could do that relatively easy. We just stripe an extra 10 feet. I mean, it's not a big deal. We don't have to go, eradicate all the lines to do that. And that's something simple that has been requested, and some agencies are already starting to do it. The other thing that you hear a lot about is, and this always surprised me when I first started talking to these guys, is they'd be like, Well, can you just give us more uniform applications of signs, markings, work zones, traffic signals? And I'm like, well, haven't you heard about this thing called the MUTCD? That's what it's all about. And we spend our life. Now, I spend my life working in the MUTCD. It's sort of my secondary Bible. It's my professional Bible, so to speak. I'm like, we already have it. But then when you start listening to them and understanding what they see as non-uniform, and you think about it from their perspective, you're like, wow, we do allow a lot of flexibility in the United States. And I'm just talking about the United States. Of course, these guys are trying to develop systems that are global, not just in the U.S. Like the VoxDOTs, that's a perfect scenario. They're not used here, apparently, because you guys aren't familiar with them. But if you go to Texas, if you go to California, it's a very common way to mark the roadways, particularly on concrete. So they would like us to work on the national uniformity of the way we mark and sign and signal our network. And they've got some great examples, but one of the most perfect examples are exit and entrance ramps. So if you drive just about any highway that has ramps, and you pay attention to the way the ramps are marked, and I guarantee it's in Georgia too, because it's everywhere I go, you'll see inconsistencies that you wouldn't otherwise recognize. But when you're trying to program vehicles to understand what a 3 foot, 3 foot gap is versus a 5 foot, 10 foot gap versus a 10-30 gap, and sometimes they're there, sometimes they're not, it's very difficult to do because we've got so much non-standard ways to do things. And so there's a lot of opportunity there. But what goes against that is if you are on the national committee and you're developing language for the MUTCD or you're making recommendations for the Green Book, most of the DOTs are asking for more flexibility to do things with engineering judgment and less of a cookbook method. So you've got one side asking for more standards and more rigidity, and the traditional side saying, let me do more engineering and let me custom a solution for that. So somehow we've got to get these two groups together and talk a little bit more about how we achieve both, particularly as we go forward with all this technology and excitement about AV. And then the last one here is contrast markings. So contrast markings are the black markings that are used to supplement white markings on usually a concrete roadway. I saw them coming in from the airport last night, so I know they're here in Georgia. There's 13 different contrast marking patterns applied in the United States. And if you listen to these people that are doing machine vision and AI, they're like, can you just give us one? We'll program for that. But when we have this many different possibilities and even more being developed all the time, we can't keep up. We can't develop a robust system. So there's some things that, you know, when you talk to the auto industry, at least on the pavement marking side, you know, you hear these things repeatedly. And there are things that I think the infrastructure industry can start to think about, because these are relatively easy things to do without losing what we've worked so hard to accomplish in terms of developing a system for human vision. And it doesn't necessarily change and add a lot of cost to what we do today, because that's generally the hurdle is, well, I already don't have enough money to maintain the system like I want to, so if you're asking me to do something that's going to cost even more, chances are I can't squeeze it in. So these are things that we could probably do without really adding any cost to what we've been doing for decades. So I was going to share with you some practices. So this is in Virginia, and here they're using 20-foot, 20-foot gap ratios on their lane lines. And the picture on the left shows a great example of if you were working on the auto side, you would love that particular situation. But generally what happens if you're in a snowplow state like Virginia, you have snowplow blade chatter. And that's what you see on the right. When the blades chatter on the pavement, they start to pop off that thermoplastic or tape or whatever it is, in this case thermoplastic. But if I were to run a machine vision system down that road right there, I would have a tough time detecting consistently with a high level of confidence this side of the road marking because it doesn't have the crisp edges I'm looking for. Thankfully, though, there's enough intelligence in those systems that they would be able to probably pick up that edge because the other edge is nice and clean still. But these are some of the things that are opportunities in this space, is how do we rethink and redesign our road marking so that we can eliminate some of these issues that are there. If we really want to make an impact on roadway safety, these are some of the things we need to be thinking about. In California, if you're keeping up with what's happening, so California did this year get rid of bot stops, at least in policy. So no new bot stops are going down in California. But they're also going to wire pavement markings and they're getting rid of paint, and they're going to thermo and tape, which are more durable products than paint. And I've been working with Caltrans to help them update their policies. And one of the things that led Caltrans down this path is this last sentence here. Of course, they've got Silicon Valley in the state, and they have a lot of pressure from all those R&D facilities out there who are trying to do AV. And so they did consult with Tesla and Google. I was in a couple meetings with them, and they've clearly come out and told Caltrans anyway that we need you to get rid of the bot stops, we need you to use wider pavement markings and maintain them to a higher standard in order to help us do what we're trying to do. And so Caltrans took it, and they're leading the country right now in terms of pavement marking policies. So they've completely overhauled their pavement marking policies this summer, and they have started changing over their entire system. So if you like bot stops, you better get out there pretty soon because they won't be around for much longer. They're primarily the only place in the United States that you can find a whole bunch of them. You can still find them in Texas and in the Houston area, but we're trying to get rid of them in Texas as well. So that gives you some flavor of what's happening in this space. The infrastructure is evolving, and it's going to continue to evolve. And I think there's a lot of opportunity to innovate and be creative as we change the way we've done things for decades. That's exciting to me. It's a great space to be in. I think there's just a lot of excitement in this area. And we're in a good place at a good time. And this is an example of some of the things happening. I think you're going to start to see more agencies follow Caltrans' lead and start to think about, well, what can I do with my roadways to start to make these systems more effective so that I can drive down these fatalities that happen? Because that's really what it's all about, is, you know, providing safer, more efficient roadways. And as much as we try to infrastructure our way out of it, it's not working. Our fatalities are still going up. So that's what I wanted to share with you about the pavement marking piece of this. I think we have some time for some discussions or questions before I get into the next topic. If you have any, I'd be happy to talk about it. So yeah, I've got one in the back.
Have you guys looked at all at where you've got faded markings and you've restriped, particularly around construction projects where they've got maybe a temporary marking up? Does that mess with machine vision at all? Or?
It does. Well, no, a lot does, particularly in the work zone environment. I mean, generally, if it's a long-term construction project and you've got, you know, lane shifts that have been eradicated or attempted to be eradicated, and then you're trying to, you know, run a current travel path along those eradicated lines that maybe isn't quite parallel to that old eradicated line, there's problems. There's problems if the, you know, in some of those constructions, you've got the edges from, you know, either your concrete or your asphalt seams that are running almost parallel to the lane lines, right? And that creates a problem. But the other thing that creates a problem with machine vision, just as much as all that, are shadowing. So if you have guardrail or concrete barrier along the road for whatever reason, and the sun is at the right time and you've got a shadow that is parallel or almost parallel to the lane line, you'll get a lot of false positives from machine vision and confusion in the machine vision. So there's certain things we can do with the infrastructure, but there's also other hurdles that are just as difficult. And you really can't solve every problem just by making changes to the infrastructure. And so those cameras are very susceptible to oversaturation from oncoming traffic at night, particularly under wet conditions. You can't really infrastructure your way out of that one either. So, you know, it's not, what we have in the vehicles today probably isn't the optimal solution, but it's a low cost, pretty darn effective solution for most scenarios. So until something else comes around that's just as low cost, that can work just as well as what we already have and get a few of these corner cases that are still out there, we're gonna probably be dealing with the you know, the camera systems, at least for this particular application and this interaction with infrastructure, for a long time. I haven't heard of a solution out there yet that's gonna trump vision systems. Anything else? Right here.
Did you do anything regarding the spectral response here? I mean, it seemed like near infrared would offer some real possibilities here.
Yeah, so before we even started this work, we were doing that internally. And we do see some potential there. But you need an emitter and a receiver for that, and OEM and tier ones haven't seen the value in that yet. So even systems today have filters on them, so it's just visible spectrum only. And until you can convince that side, right?